Good morning. Today we are going to solve free response question number 3 from the 2017 AP Physics 1 exam. Bobby, please read the problem through part A.
Flippin' physics.
The left end of a rod of length D and rotational inertia I is attached to a frictionless horizontal surface by a frictionless pivot as shown. Point C marks the center, midpoint, of the rod. The rod is initially motionless but is free to rotate around the pivot. A student will slide a disc of mass m sub disc toward the rod with velocity v naught perpendicular to the rod, and the disc will stick to the rod a distance x from the pivot. The student wants the rod disc system to end with as much angular speed as possible. Part A. Suppose the rod is much more massive than the disc. To give the rod as much angular speed as possible, should the student make the disc hit the rod to the left of point C, at point C, or to the right of point C? Briefly explain your reasoning without manipulating equations. What does that mean? Explain your reasoning without manipulating equations? The answer depends on equations, right?
Yeah, Bobby, what they're asking for here is a paragraph response rather than an answer which manipulates equations to solve for the answer. Likely, you will need to discuss equations in your paragraph response. However, you are not going to rearrange equations.
Okay.
Billy, could you please answer part A?
Sure. The angular momentum of the disc before the collision is linearly proportional to the distance the disc strikes the rod from the axis of rotation of the rod, and that distance is x. Therefore, a larger x value will mean a larger initial angular momentum of the system. Because angular momentum is conserved about the pivot during the collision, this will mean a larger final angular momentum of the system. Because angular momentum equals rotational inertia times angular velocity, a larger final angular momentum will mean a larger final angular speed. Therefore, a larger value of x will mean a larger final angular speed. Therefore, the student should slide the disc to the right of C. So put a mark by to the right of C.
We could also do this in terms of torque rather than angular momentum, right, Mr. P?
Yes, Bo, that is correct. Could you please give us that answer?
Yeah. A larger distance x from the axis of rotation will mean a larger net torque applied by the disc on the rod. A larger net torque will mean a larger angular acceleration of the rod during the collision, which will mean a larger final angular velocity of the rod after the collision. So again, the student should slide the disc to the right of C.
Thanks, Bo. Could you please read part B?
Part B. On the internet, a student finds the following equation for the post-collision angular speed omega of the rod in this situation. Angular velocity equals the mass of the disc times the distance x times velocity of the disc v naught, all divided by the rotational inertia of the rod. Regardless of whether this equation for angular speed is correct, does it agree with your qualitative reasoning in part A? In other words, does this equation for angular velocity have the expected dependence as reasoned in part A? Yes or no? Briefly explain your reasoning without deriving an equation for angular velocity.
Again with the prohibition on equation manipulation.
Yeah.
Yes, Billy, this is another paragraph response. Bobby, could you please answer part B?
Well, our qualitative reasoning in part A states that a larger distance x results in a larger final angular velocity of the rod. The student's equation also shows that a larger x results in a larger omega. Therefore, yes, the equation does have the expected dependence. Put a mark by yes.
Thank you, Bobby. A quick note about grading. This is from the scoring guidelines. If no is selected, the explanation may still earn full credit if an incorrect selection was made in part A. In other words, if you get part A wrong, you can still get full credit for part B. Please answer every part of every question. Billy, could you please read and answer part C?
Yes. Part C. Another student deriving an equation for the post-collision angular speed omega of the rod makes a mistake and comes up with angular velocity equals the rotational inertia of the rod times x, the distance the disc strikes the rod from the axis of rotation, times v naught, the initial speed of the disc, all divided by the quantity mass of the disc times d, the length of the rod, to the fourth power. Without deriving the correct equation, how can you tell that this equation is not plausible? In other words, that it does not make physical sense. Briefly explain your reasoning. Okay, paragraph response again. We know a larger mass of the disk will result in a larger initial angular momentum of the disk about the pivot, which will result in a larger final angular momentum of the rod disk system, which will result in a larger final angular velocity of the rod. However, according to the student's equation, the mass of the disk would be inversely proportional to the final angular velocity of the rod, which is the reverse of what I just said, so that explains why the student's equation is not plausible.
Thank you, Billy. Bobby, could you please read the preamble and part D?
For parts D and E, do not assume that the rod is much more massive than the disk. Part D, immediately before colliding with the rod, the disk's rotational inertia about the pivot is the mass of the disk times x squared, and its angular momentum with respect to the pivot is the mass of the disk times v naught times x. Derive an equation for the post-collision angular speed omega of the rod. Express your answer in terms of the length of the rod, the mass of the disk, the rotational inertia of the rod, x, v naught, and physical constants as appropriate. Oh, so we actually get to manipulate equations, right?
That is correct, Bobby. Now please solve part D.
Sure. Okay, so we know angular momentum with an axis of rotation at the pivot is conserved during the collision. That means the angular momentum of the rod initial plus the angular momentum of the disk initial equals the angular momentum of the rod final plus the angular momentum of the disk final. The rod is initially at rest, so it has zero initial angular momentum. The initial angular momentum of the disk equals the mass of the disk times the initial velocity of the disk times x. Both of the final angular momenta equal rotational inertia times final angular velocity with subscripts of rod and disk respectively. The rod and the disk are stuck together after the collision, so they have the same angular velocity. Angular velocity final. The rotational inertia of the rod is just the variable I. The rotational inertia of the disk is the rotational inertia of a particle, so it is the mass of the disk times the square of the distance the disk is from the axis of rotation, or x squared. Okay, we can factor out angular velocity final and divide both sides by the quantity rotational inertia of the rod plus mass of the disk times x squared. That means the final angular velocity of the rod and disk both equal the mass of the disk times v naught times x, all divided by the quantity, the rotational inertia of the rod plus the mass of the disk times x squared. It feels good to actually have done some math. I can't believe I just said that.
I believe it.
I believe it too. Thank you, Bobby. A quick point about grading. This is from the scoring guidelines. You gain 1 point for indicating that the initial angular momentum of the system is equal to the mass of the disk times v naught times x. In other words, you can get 1 point for simply identifying that the initial angular momentum of the rod is zero, and therefore the initial angular momentum of the system is the angular momentum of the disk only. That is essentially the very first step in solving the problem, and even if you did not know how to solve this problem, that is something you should be able to identify. So please, always write something down that you think is probably correct, even if you do not know how to solve the whole problem. Bo, please read and answer part E.
Part E. Consider the collision for which your equation in part D was derived, except now suppose the disk bounces backward off the rod instead of sticking to the rod. Is the post-collision angular speed of the rod when the disk bounces off it greater than, less than, or equal to the post-collision angular speed of the rod when the disk sticks to it? Briefly explain your reasoning. This is another sentence-based argument rather than equations. Okay, assuming the initial direction of the disk's motion is positive, when the disk bounces off the rod, it will have a negative velocity and a negative angular momentum instead of a positive angular momentum when the disk sticks to the rod. Because angular momentum is conserved about the pivot during the collision, the final angular momentum of the rod will need to have a larger positive value in order to add up to the same initial angular momentum.
Because the final angular momentum of the rod is larger, the final angular velocity of the rod is also greater than the original final angular velocity. So put a mark next to greater than.
Is post-collision one word or two?
Very nice, Bo. And Billy, I've never seen post-collision written as one word except on this AP exam, but I guess that is how words become words, right?
Okay.
One last comment about grading. Part E is worth 2 points, 1 point for describing what happens to the rod, and 1 point for describing what happens to the disc. There are two objects in this problem. You need to describe what happens to both objects. Keep that in mind for future problems with multiple objects. You need to make sure to give a complete description of what happens to each of the objects and why. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.